Hey, hello friends, I'm back again with another video, and this time it'll be a bit long because we will be doing a complete and step-by-step installation of Koha. Since you are here after clicking the video thumbnail, I assume you already know what Koha is, but for those who have never heard about it, here's a quick intro. Koha is an integrated library management software. It is one of the best open source projects which is developed and maintained by a community of users and developers who are open source enthusiasts. Its development started in 1999 in New Zealand by Katipo Communications. In Maori language, which is one of the native languages of New Zealand, Koha means a gift without conditions. It is known for its flexibility, extensibility and ease of use, which is why this feature-rich ILS is being used in many schools, colleges, and university libraries worldwide. By the sense of open source, it means that anybody can change the source code of the software to scale and mold it as per their needs without any legal restriction. It is most advanced, feature-rich, and cost-effective software solution, which can serve the needs of all small and big libraries. Some of notable features include full-text searching, Z39.50 or SIU support. It also supports latest bibliographic formats like MARC21 and UNIMARC. The main reason why people like this software is because it is web-based, which means once it is installed on the server, no special client is needed to access it over the network. It just works like any other website on the internet. Yes, you need a web browser though, but basically you can use it on any phone, tablet or PC. It just makes things very easy for the users and also for the library staff. The only reason people find it difficult is because of its steep learning curve, that too in the installation part only, because the Koha packages and software dependencies are developed for Linux exclusively, and that's what people are mostly scared of. With this video, we'll try to make its installation easy by breaking up into small and simple steps. If you follow them precisely, I promise it'll make the installation and troubleshooting a piece of cake for you. So enough of this chit-chat, let's get to work. And here I am on my Linux desktop. For this purpose, I'm using Ubuntu Linux 19.10. And we can check this version using this command in terminal, lsb_release-a, and it clearly shows that we are using 19.10. Alternatively, you can go to details and then scroll down below, go to details. There also you'll find the version of your operating system and other hardware details of your PC. Now, before proceeding any further, it is suggested to ensure that your base OS is up to date. To do this, we first need to run apt-get upgrade, which updates the local package index with the latest changes made in the software repository, and then apt-get upgrade command, which actually fetches the latest packages from the internet. We run these commands with sudo prefix, which tells the system that we are performing all these actions with super user privileges, which is why we need to put in the root password while executing these commands. And then finally, apt-get clean command, which just flushes out the obsolete cache files from the package repository. Then we need to add the third-party repository in our source list, which hosts the Koha package files. To do this, we need to issue the following command: echo space deb space http://debian.koha-community.org/koha, then the Koha stable release. It's the main source, so we type main, then we just mention the location where to append this URL. Don't worry, you don't need to remember all this hocus pocus, because everything is mentioned in the description section of this video and also available on Koha Wiki, so you just need to copy paste and it'll work. So yeah. Now issue wget command to download the GPG keys from this URL, https://debian.koha-community.org/koha/gpg.asc, and then add these to system trusted keys, which will verify and authenticate that the Koha packages downloaded from this source are from a legitimate repository. Okay, and it's done. Then we'll quickly update our package list by issuing the update and upgrade command, and then we'll clean the caches. Now that our system knows where to get the Koha package files, we just need to give it a go. To download the software, issue the following command: sudo apt-get install koha-common. Type yes to give your consent for the installation, and it'll start fetching the Koha software files from the repository we just added. This command will download, unpack, and install the package files and other dependencies, including Apache Server, Zebra libraries, Perl dependencies, etc. And it'll automatically place all the things where they need to be. You just have to sit back and relax. This entire execution process may take some time depending upon your internet speed and also your system specifications. So it may vary from mine to yours, but since this is a video, we can speed up things a little bit. And as they say, no news is a good news. Because the terminal returned no error or any kind of warning sign, it means that Koha package is installed perfectly. Which also means we are all set to go to /etc/koha folder to edit koha-sites.conf file using the nano editor to make changes to the port numbers for OPEC and staff interface of Koha. When you open this configuration file, you see that the intra port specifies the port number on which your Koha staff interface works. For most people who access the staff interface from their office network only, we use port number 8080 for intra port and port 80 for the OPEC, which is default for all HTTP websites. But in case you want your staff to have access to the Koha admin interface from anywhere on the internet, you can keep it to port number 80 only, but then you will have to map these two interfaces to discrete domains, like I'm doing here for the OPEC only. But my staff interface still works on port 8080 using my IP number. And after making the changes, just press Ctrl X, which will exit the file, and press Y to save the changes. And you are back onto the terminal. Now it's time to move to the next step, which is to install Database Engine. Many users have reported some bugs in MySQL while using with this version of Koha. So as an easy alternate, we can go with MariaDB, which is equally good and is no less than MySQL in any way. To install it, we issue this command: sudo apt-get install MariaDB-server, and press Y to confirm that we want to install this, and it will again download it from the repository and install the software onto your PC. While this is being downloaded and unpacked, I must also brief you with the pros and cons of installing Koha from the scratch instead of using a pre-installed bootable live CD. See, the thing is, live CD installation also works very well, no harm, no foul. It's easy for a non-techie, just put in the CD, install the OS, and you can directly log in and import your data. But the real trouble comes when there is a problem in the system, because you don't know how to fix it. On the other hand, when you install the entire system on your own, in the manual way, you know how you did what you did. Later on, if any problem arises, you'll know how to troubleshoot it and where to find the solution. Another thing is, as a librarian or as a system admin, you'll require the usernames and passwords for each and every program installed on your Koha server. In case of live CDs, many times what happens, only the system credentials or the Koha admin credentials are provided by the CD developer. And most of the time, librarians also don't really bother to change the passwords, which leads to serious security vulnerabilities. And most importantly, you learn when you do things practically. So I always recommend to install it from the scratch. And it's very easy also, so better do it yourself. So now our database engine is installed and Koha package is installed, including Apache web server. We are all set to create our first Koha instance, but before that we need to enable some Apache modules so that our web server can interact with our database and Koha sites files later. In order to do so, we issue these commands: sudo a2enmod rewrite, and another module would be CGI module, which can be activated with sudo a2enmod CGI. And after having these Apache modules enabled, just restart the Apache server so that your system could recognize the changes you just made. And now we can fire up our Koha instance and its corresponding database with the command sudo koha-create space dash dash create dash db space library. Library would be the name of our instance. This will create a database in MariaDB and also several configuration files like the Koha sites folder, etc. But before we go on to open the web interface, there is one more thing to do. We need to tell the Apache server to accept HTTP requests on port 80 and on port 8080 as well, because Koha will serve different pages on these two distinct interfaces. So we'll add this line to the ports.conf file to instruct Apache server to listen on port 80 and port 8080. Then press Ctrl X to save changes and exit the nano editor. To activate this new configuration in the web server, we need to depopulate Apache from any previous settings. To disable the default web page of Apache, use this command sudo a2dis site. Then press 000 and press tab. It will automatically fill in the rest of the name, because this is the usual name of default Apache web page. Then enable our Koha interface using this command sudo a2ensite library. Then as usual, restart Apache service to apply the changes system wide. Okay, so now that our configuration part is done, we can start the web installer from the browser. Just point it to http://localhost:8080, and this should take us to the Koha administration screen. But wait, it's asking for a username and password, and we don't have these. No, here's the fun part. See, these super user credentials are randomly generated by the system and are hidden at a safe place. We just need to find it. The password can be located at an XML file in the root and then etc folder, then Koha, then sites, then library folder, which is the name of the instance we created, then Koha conf.xml file. Now this file is very important because it contains all the connection settings and other vital information related to the Zebra server, the bibliographic records and the authority records. Then if you scroll down further, you'll reach this database connection settings, and there you can find this password string. Yeah, here it is. This is the password which Koha has generated for you automatically, and you can copy this string to somewhere safe temporarily because it will be used only for once. But if you don't want to open Koha conf file and accidentally mess up with it, you can choose this alternative way to echo and print this temporary password directly into the terminal window by using this long command sudo xml start blah blah blah. This command will go to the exact same location and fetch out only one line from the XML file. And as I said, you don't need to remember all these commands. Just copy and paste it from the description section of this video. Our up-to-date instructions are always available on the Koha Wiki, so why bother? See, this is the same password we saw in the Koha conf.xml file. Now you just need to copy it and paste it somewhere safe, like in a notepad. And the username for our Koha instance would be Koha underscore name of the instance which you created. In our case, it is library, so the username would be Koha underscore library, and the password we have obtained from this XML file, which is written in this terminal window, we are copying it and pasting it here. Yeah, and we'll save it temporarily on the desktop. I'm calling it temporary password because these credentials works only during the web installer. After that, Koha won't let you log in using these. So for this time, we'll use co_library for the username, and this password is the password string. And click on login, and it will bring us to the language selection screen, and we'll choose English as the default language and proceed to the next step. After checking some Perl dependencies, it will bring us to the database connection screen, where it will test if Koha is able to connect with our MariaDB database. And here it verifies that the database Koha_library exists and we have all the required privileges on it. And then we'll continue with the next step, and it will populate that database with some required tables and some required values. Yeah, so all the tables are created now. We'll proceed to the next step. In the next step, it will make some basic configuration in the Koha installation. And like in this screen, it is asking which flavor of Mark we want to go with. We'll choose Mark 21 for us. And then we'll land on this long page where some sample data and templates are available for Mark 21 framework. Some of them are mandatory, and there are a few optional settings as well. Like here it asks if we want to set up a matching rule on the basis of ISBN or ISSN number of any record, and if we want to add a fast add attribute, and if we want to set a bibliographic framework for books, CDs, DVDs in our collection, and there are these mandatory data fields. Then in the optional section, it asks us if we want to set up any basic default authorized value for library locations and lost item status, any CSV profile, any coded value for the periodicals, any MARC code related terms, and any basic currency like USA dollars and euros, any if you want to show the barcode on the patron screen. And there are some patron categories as well, which are popular ones. You can import these. And then there is some sample holidays, some sample news items and quotations. Also, this gives you a list of Z39.50 and SIU server locations like Library of Congress and Columbia University. This will be a huge deal for your cataloging staff later on. So you can take these options. And then click on import to import these settings into the database. And yes. So all these default data is loaded and populated into the database, and these settings have been configured, and it shows that our basic installation is complete. We can proceed to the next step, and it also notifies us that if we want to share the usage statistics with the Koha developer team, we can choose to do so in the administration menu. And congratulations, your web installation is complete, and this page will automatically refresh within 10 seconds. If it doesn't, just click here. And finally, we are asked to set up some initial settings for our library, like the name of the library and a unique code value. In my case, it is Jadunath Bhavan Museum and Resource Center, so I'll type it here. And the library code I'll mention as JBMRC. The code has to be unique if you are using multiple library setup in one instance. Then click Submit. So our library is created. Now it's time to create the first user, which will be our super librarian. So I'll create one user with the surname Chatterjee, and his first name would be Anupam, and I'll provide a card number which has to be unique like any of your library card, and then I'll choose a library on which this staff belongs to. The category would be staff. I'll choose a username for the staff, and these credentials will be used for logging in as a super user. So make sure you use a complex and a strong password for this, and click on submit. And in the next screen, it will ask to create some circulation rules. We'll select a library branch and a patron category on which these circulation rules will apply to. In our case, one rule will apply to all the categories, so we'll choose all. And we want to allow only 2 books per user, so we'll choose 2, and the loan period for the book issue will be of 30 days only, and we want them to renew each book twice only for a period of 15 days, and we don't want to allow any on-shelf holds. This is my case. You can configure as per your need, and just click save, and we'll start using Koha. Here we need to log in using the username and password we just created for the super librarian, because this Koha_library user will no longer work. Once you are logged in, you will be presented with an administration screen of Koha, and you can see all the modules are present. You can do whatever you want. For now, we'll go to about screen and we'll check that our latest Koha version is installed, which is 19.11. So our Koha is installed and we can go on adding the staff members, library users, start cataloging books and do whatever. The ground is open to explore. It was easy, right? See, that's what I told you. But if you still face any difficulty in any of the steps, or there is some issue with the existing installation of yours, just drop a comment below, I'll try to answer it. Or write me an email. My email address is mentioned in the description section of this video. But don't spam me, okay? Nobody likes spammers. And I'm also planning to make another video on different methods of import, export in Koha and migration of data from one system to the another. And let's see how and when it comes out. But that's all for now. And I'm not gonna ask you to like, share, subscribe, all that stuff YouTubers say. If this all exercise has been helpful for you in any way, that's all that matters. So thanks for watching and goodbye.